Welcome, welcome to Money Life. This is Sucheta Dilal. What are we talking about today? It's about your bank account portability. You may have noticed that in previous video blogs over the last few weeks, we have talked about the hassles of know your customer requirements, KYC as it's called, how accounts are frozen, people are hassled. There's a simple solution to all of this. You entrust a bank with your money. What is the best solution to ensure the bank treats you well, does not missell products, doesn't call you to take your money out and of FDs and put it in a unit-linked insurance plan? It's very simple. It's bank account portability. Now, all of you know how it works in telecom. You have a simple way of sending an SMS and you can ask to port, switch, move to another service provider. Should be exactly the same with a bank account. Doesn't work like that, doesn't it? Why does that happen? Because in fact, technology, which is the enabler, which has allowed telecom portability, has been used by banks to tie us as customers so tightly to themselves through a variety of services that they offer. So they give you direct debits on your credit card payments, they have utility bill payments, they have all kinds of things, alerts. So you think you're so tied into a particular bank, the process of closing an account is so tedious. They make you unravel it slowly and it takes forever. So people remain lethargic, remain stuck to a bank, and constantly crib on social media about poor service. This should end. This is a form of slavery. Technology, instead of being an enabler, has made us slaves to particular banks. We complain about mis-selling, but we don't move out. And if there is bank account portability, it would be very simple. Now, you would say, why has it happened? Believe it or not, the RBI has begun the process for this way back 9 years ago in 2012, when it asked banks to set up unique customer IDs, which means that there will be one customer ID, UCIC, which will tie in all transactions of a customer, all instructions, nominations, everything across the bank and its services to this one number. So whatever you do with that bank will be linked to one number. The idea was that through this number, sometime in the future, you should be able to port. In fact, in 2012, when RBI introduced this, they thought that in 3 years' time, bank portability would be a possibility. Of course, things worked very differently, because after 2014, you had all the pressure on Aadhaar, and suddenly there was talk about linking Aadhaar cards, PAN cards, link them to your bank account, then use the National Payments Corporation. All this is not required. Those of you who know us at Money Life know that we've been resisting Aadhaar linkages, which are being made mandatory. We don't think that makes it safer, but it is possible to do it. Now, bank account portability is very much a possibility. Why is it being stopped? Obviously, vested interests in the large banks, both public sector and private sector. Now, remember, 2014 was when telecom portability came in. At that time also, it happened only after a lot of resistance, but complaints were sky high. Your tariff plans were opaque, things were difficult. The minute portability was a possibility, the mindset changes and the telecom company is wooing you. It's either wooing you to join them with better services or to stop you from leaving them, and things have become more transparent. So there was a huge churn in 2014 for a while, and things have settled down. Today, more or less, everybody's offering good service. They're listening to the customer. Tariff plans are more transparent. Exactly the same is going to happen with banks. Yes, there will be a churn, but is it a bad thing? People say there will be disruption because there are too many bank accounts. Hello, there are more telecom accounts, and disruption over the last 9 years is considered a good thing everywhere else. Why not for banks? Why? Only because it benefits the customer, and we, the customers, are disparate people, no cohesive group, no lobbying. And that's why nobody listens to us. Now, let's look at how this has moved. I'm going to take you through the process of what has happened over the years. So 2012, like I talked about, is when RBI issued two circulars. One is it asked banks to create a unique customer ID that I talked about before. Banks dragged their feet over it, but RBI persisted. There was another circular in 2013, another one in 2014. I hear from bankers that almost every bank has a UCIC in place. We ourselves have seen inspection reports of Punjab and Maharashtra Cooperative Bank, where we know that every year the inspectors didn't notice anything else that was wrong, but identified the fact that UCIC wasn't properly done. And in fact, that was eventually the reason for the mess over there. In 2002, RBI also issued another notification. It asked banks to permit intra-bank account portability. That's already being done, which means that if you have an account with a bank in Bombay, the same account will hold with the same number if you get transferred to Delhi or Chennai or anywhere else in the country within the same bank. That's called intra-bank portability. So they expected 3 years later that there would be bank account portability in place. Nothing of that kind happened. In fact, in 2015, the Financial Conduct Authority of the UK released a report on various models through which this could be implemented, and many countries in Europe and others began to adopt it. Not India though. In India, the big push was on Aadhaar and on NPCI and a centralized payment system. Remember, at all this time, everyone was gung-ho about technology and how it's going to be a game changer, it's going to deliver results. Why then are we bank customers crying? Because technology has not been allowed to benefit us, except in small ways, which is that you are able to do an RTGS and an NEFT, and that's not good enough. That was pushed by the capital market. We are not going to discuss it over here. Big move happened in 2017 when the then RBI Deputy Governor S.S. Mundra announced that bank, like a threat, that portability was not just a possibility, but he admitted what we are saying all the time, that it would be a far-reaching step towards enhancing competition and improving customer service. That's exactly what we are saying. He also said digital banking would play a huge role in enabling this to happen through apps like Bheem, IMPS and UPI. No, I think that's not good enough. It has to be your proper bank account, and that's also a possibility. In fact, readers of Money Life would know that around 2017, we had this major change.org petition, which was signed by over 3.4 lakh people, where we talked about a whole lot of things that we wanted banks to do. And we said it was titled Stop Fleecing Customers. We even had a tweet morcha along with Congress Member of Parliament Sanjay Nirupam. All this in 2017, a lot of enthusiasm, looked like it's happening. Exactly 1 year to the date that Mr. Mundra said bank account portability was possible, it is on the back burner. This shows you the kind of pressure there was from the Indian Banks Association and others, because Zee News reported that it's been put on the back burner for a various vague reasons, mainly technology, disruption, how banks are not prepared, too many accounts, not possible, which is, if you ask me, plain rubbish. A central banker tells me that Indian Banks Association is delaying implementation on the plea that core banking platforms are not ready. Now, this is very interesting, because if these core banking platforms are not ready, then how on earth is the government pushing bank mergers of large PSU banks? Isn't that a lot more difficult? Clearly, banks haven't dared to resist that. They can resist this because it's about the customers, not about deserving government. So, I don't believe it. RBI's reluctance to push portability is also clear. I spoke to two former deputy governors of the Reserve Bank of India, and you know, you can make out from their comments that they're strongly opposed. So one of them argues that banking is different from telecom. Customers already have multiple bank accounts. That is, we, the privileged tax-paying kind of customers. We're not talking about those who desperately needed to get a Jandhan account and many who still don't have one. Okay, so he says that people don't want to put their eggs in one basket. True, people don't. That is for safety reasons. But now that you have 5 lakh safe because deposit insurance guarantee is enhanced, we can take a risk. And it's precisely for safety that we want to be with the best bank, and we want it to be easy to move to a better bank, which gives better services, safer, and treats us well, does not send its relationship managers to rip us off with all kinds of dubious products. So I completely disagree with this point of view. And The second thing he talks about is data confidentiality. He says banking is, again, the point that RBI makes all the time, even to deny information against RTI. It's so full of confidential information. Hello, today your telephone has all your financial transactions. If you can port a telephone number with all that data, then why is banking any different? In any case, data sharing is already happening. Every bank has to give your credit history to 4 credit bureaus, not one, not just CIBIL, but 4 of them, right? And you can go to any ATM of any bank and withdraw and deposit money, which means some amount of sharing and linkage of technology is already in place. So this business about confidentiality is also not correct. Another central banker, who, while agreeing that banks are opposed to it, or other big banks are opposed to it, says something very interesting and correct. He says there has never been a frank and holistic debate on the need, desirability, capability, methodology, or cost benefit of permitting bank account portability. Why is that? Because banks don't want it. If banks wanted it, or if RBI had the will to force it, or the government had the will to make things safer and better for us, the largest stakeholders, the consumers, they would have ensured that there is an action plan, and there would be a rollout plan, there would be an announcement, a date, and things would get going. But he says we've not even achieved proper intra-bank portability, especially between domestic and international bank accounts. Whose fault is that? I think the buck stops at the Reserve Bank of India. There's another advantage here, which is the RBI has permitted new banks to come in. They bring in much needed competition. They offer higher interest rates. Most of us are worried, or were worried, because we wondered how safe they are. Now, like I said, 5 lakhs is safe. Those banks will be going out of their way to woo us as customers, and we would be safe to at least deposit up to 5 lakhs over there. But a banker tells me they don't have a voice because the big daddies, the SBI, the State Bank of India, the nationalized banks, the big private banks like HDFC and ICICI, they call the shots. Even at meetings with the RBI, there's a pecking order in which people are allowed to speak. So they don't get a chance. So now let's come to what are the 2 things that you really need for bank account portability. Like I said, a unique customer ID, which is already in place, which links everything that you do to one number which can be ported, right? The second thing that is required is a centralized KYC. If you're going to port your account number and have to go through the same tedious process all over again, it's no fun, it's irritating, and no different from what you are doing. So you need a centralized KYC. Believe it or not, even this is available through an organization which is 51% owned by the government of India, called CERSAI, C-E-R-S-A-I. This is a central registry which, among various other things, operates and maintains a KYC registry. It's a centralized KYC registry. The idea was that this single registry works across regulators. So whether you're buying insurance, pension, or doing a banking transaction, or opening a brokerage and demat account, you will not have to sign 30, 40 pages. And if you're a small company like ours, hundreds of them, paper-based, self-attested PAN cards, which means that your documents, personal documents, are floating around all over the place with a self-attested signature. We don't know what happens to them. All this would be over. And CERSAI's central KYC not only maintains a record, but it painstakingly verifies each account. So this is a verified KYC, not a self-attested thing that you deposit with the bank. So it already has 22 crore accounts, already covers RBI, SEBI, IRDA. I mean, I'm sure the question in your mind is, if all this is in place, why on earth are we being harassed for KYC? Why is it that every time you open a new DMAT account or a brokerage account, you go through the same painful process? If you ask me, we will have to file a public interest litigation to figure out why this CERSAI centralized KYC, which is verified, is not becoming the one-stop shop for doing KYC. Why are we being harassed at all? But litigation is slow and difficult. Somebody has to bell the cat. Maybe that somebody will come forward. But till then, either the government nor the regulators bother to answer us. I keep saying we are the largest stakeholder, whether as investors or depositors or buyers of insurance, but we are the only people that nobody speaks to, not even our parliamentarians, because we are not a vote bank. As tax-paying people who save and who buy all these products, we don't matter. That's why we need to think differently and we need to act. So the only hurdle, if anything, to portability is the lack of will. So this government, which has a strong will and determination to push through all kinds of regulations, acts, whether it is your GST, which is still faulty, forcing you to do online filings with MCA 21, which is still faulty, can easily do this. We need to see, will Governor Shaktikanta Das bite the bullet and push it through? Let's hope he does. Meanwhile, in your own way, don't forget that this is about you, about your rights, about your savings being safer. So spread the word, begin to ask questions. If you like what we do, tell people about this video, make them aware, spread financial awareness. Thank you.